Good evening. I'm Richard Griffiths. I'm the president of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. On behalf of the Board of Directors, I'd like to welcome you to the 18th Annual Charles L. Weltner Freedom of Information Award Banquet, which also coincides, I'm very happy to say, with our 25th anniversary. So that is an applause moment. I want to thank our sponsors for their support of this event, the work it honors, and the cause it serves. They're identified on this screen and on page 3 of your programs. We would not be able to do our work without them, and so thank you so much. In particular, I'd like to call out the continued support from Kilpatrick, Townsend, and my former colleagues at CNN, a gold sponsor, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. Thank you to LexisNexis, Caplan Cobb, and Jones Day for their support. Let me also introduce you to some of the distinguished guests tonight. If you hold up a hand when I call your name so that people can find you, I would appreciate it. Former Weltner Award nominees, or honorees, excuse me, Vernon Keenan, who this year retired as the director of the Georgia Bureau of Investigation. Cobb County Senior Judge Jim Bodiford. There you go. Former Georgia Open Government Heroes Tom Bennett. And Nydia Tisdale are here tonight as well. Thank you. Georgia Attorney General Chris Carr will be joining us a little later this evening. Oh, there you are, front row. He made it. The Emory traffic, we were told, the Emory traffic. Solicitor General Andrew Pinson is here. As is Deputy Solicitor General Ross Bergathon, and also from the Georgia Department of Law, we're pleased to welcome Dennis Dunn and Russ Willard. So, thank you. Several Georgia Supreme Court justices have joined us this evening. Please welcome Chief Justice Harold Melton. Presiding Justice David Namias, as well as Justices Robert Benham, Michael Boggs, and Nels Peterson. Thank you. Justice Melton, I'm pleased to say, will be our keynote tonight. We're honored to have late Justice Chief Justice Harris Hines family to accept our Weltner Freedom of Information Award as a tribute to his legacy. Helen Hayes, Hines is here. From the Georgia Court of Appeals, we're delighted to welcome Chief Judge Christopher McFadden, Presiding Judge Ann Barnes, and Judge Elizabeth Goble. I see Atlanta Journal-Constitution editor Kevin Riley and publisher Donna Hall, as is Suzanne Nadel, news director at WSB-TV. I'd like to call out some of my esteemed former colleagues from CNN, Tim Langmaid, Drew Schenkman, Laura Bernardini, and Samira Jafari, who's also on our board. This room is filled with journalists from students to veterans who are making sure accountability journalism lives and breathes every day, and thank you to all of them. Representing Cobb County, in addition to Judge Bodiford, is Commissioner Lisa Cupid, who will be joining us a little bit later. Lisa Cupid is on our board of directors and whose perspective and wisdom on our board is much appreciated. DeKalb Superior Court Judge Asher Jackson is here, as well as DeKalb Judges Shondina Morris and Holly Mannheimer. Holly Mannheimer, also on the Foundation's Board of Directors. We're pleased to have Chief Judge Peggy Walker here from Douglas County. And from Fulton County Superior Court, we have Senior Judge John Goger, Judge Paige Reese Whitaker. And it's always a great pleasure to have members of the Weltner family with us. The late Justice Weltner's daughter, Susan Yao, and her husband, Richard, are here with us. They are dear friends of this organization, and Susan will present our award a little later. Finally, with the George First Amendment Foundation board members, just give a quick wave. Our board is very pleased you've joined us for tonight's celebration. Enjoy your dinner. We'll resume the program in a few minutes. I come from television, and in television, you have to be very flexible with a rundown because you want to make the program work as effectively as you can. So Hyde and I conspired a little bit. We're not quite going with the way things are written in the program, but we are going to get underway. I want to start off by introducing the man who got us all here today. The Georgia First Amendment Foundation would not exist without Hyde Post, our co-founder and longtime president. I'm not done saying all the nice things yet. Hyde established the foundation's pattern of collaborating with public officials, even as we hold them accountable. He led the organization's efforts to educate lawmakers about the importance of preserving and strengthening public access. And he did this important work not only in Georgia, but on the national level as president of the nonprofit National Freedom of Information Coalition. In fact, he was inducted into the National FOIC Open Government Hall of Fame this year. In a long career at the AJC, he blazed digital trails and he edited stories that won Pulitzer Prizes. Well, tonight we're honoring Hyde with our Founders Award. Please welcome Hyde Post to the stage.
We're supposed to stand here for two.
Yeah, look at this. Look at all these people.
I'm going to put this down.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you for this award. I'm delighted to accept it in honor of and with enormous thanks to all of those who have given their time and energy to serve on the foundation staff and the foundation board over the last 25 years, and to all of you who have supported it during that time. I do want to give a particular shout out to the AJC and to Cox. They provided the initial seed money for the First Amendment Foundation back when we started, and they've been supporters ever since, strong supporters. I also want to give a shout out to Peter Canfield and Dennis Berry and Jay Smith in particular. They played critical roles at the very beginning in helping the foundation get on its feet and stay there when we started to teeter, which we did on several occasions. I also want to give a special thanks to Tom Bennett and Holly Mannheimer, who are both here, and to Tom Clyde, who's here, and Carolyn Carlson, and to Tom Budlong, all people, and Jerry Weber, and I don't know whether Jerry's here or not, but they were all people who were willing to take a chance on a foundation that didn't really have any precedent in Georgia. And they were active in helping us become a real statewide resource on open records and open meetings law. When we started, Georgia was one of the first states to actually create a nonprofit specifically to promote and defend this idea that a government of, by, and for the people also needs to be open to those people. There are now more than 40 states with active FOI foundations. Some are very impressive and, frankly, much better funded than ours. But with great thanks to those who currently lead our foundation with, I guarantee, way more talent, vision, and professionalism than I was ever able to muster. I would argue that the Georgia First Amendment Foundation today is one of the strongest in the country. And I would also argue that Georgia has one of the best open records and meeting laws in the country. That's due not only to the work of the foundation, but also to strong support in the legislature, strong support from the Attorney General's office over the years, and strong support from the judiciary. The fight for government transparency can be enormously frustrating. When we went through the 9/11 Patriot Act period, when national security was an excuse for closing doors and records at seemingly every turn, I think I said then, and I probably said it at this dinner, I said it a lot, I can imagine no time when the threats to open government and Freedom of Information Act could be any greater than they are today. Suffice it to say, I am a person of extremely limited vision and imagination. I never saw Donald Trump coming. According to the AP, the Trump administration has the record. They've achieved the FOIA record, the First Amendment, First Freedom of Information Act record, for being the least transparent in American history, releasing censored files or none at all in response to 78% of Freedom of Information Act requests last year. Tonight is an evening to honor the late Justice Hines, who was a wonderful friend, personal friend, and a foundation supporter. I don't want to take much of your time, but a couple of encouragements for the road ahead. I urge you, all of you open government warriors out there, whenever you have in Georgia an occasion where there is a groundswell of public outrage over something that government is hiding from the people or wants to keep secret, whenever that happens, take full advantage of that public outrage. Make it work for you. It is in those very infrequent moments when the public gets really angry about government secrecy, when they feel that they're being tricked, that people embrace the First Amendment. They remember it's theirs. They remember the value of open government and a free and independent press. It's in those moments that you can nudge the cause of open government forward. For too much of the rest of the time, I'm afraid, we play defense. We push back on an endless queue of interest groups. They're all clamoring to have their business with the government hidden from the public who pays the bills for it. That shouldn't be the way. I also urge you to be increasingly vigilant about the media platforms that dominate now in providing the news and information people consume. Today, in a very real way, algorithms rule the court of public opinion. As the newspaper die-off continues, and as much of the broadcast news is relegated to the margins of a live stream world, one where entertainment options too often win out over current affairs, who remains to inform the public? We live now in a country where, according to Pew Research, more than two-thirds of Americans say they rely on social media for most, if not all, of their news. More than 42% of people get their news from Facebook. Pew found that people may not entirely trust Facebook or the news that they read there, but it has become a hardcore news habit. I would suggest that this is not always a good thing for informed and constructive civic engagement or for facts. In broadcast, there used to be the fairness doctrine to require a diversity of viewpoints. For too many Americans today who check their preferred feeds online 20 times or more a day, today's reality is that if statements or links affirm a personal bias that they have, If statements affirm a personal bias, they don't have to be true to be embraced. They just have to sound credible, at least to the folks in that partisan bubble, be it left or right. Folks will then amplify them, share them, and those statements become the truth for their tribe. At its worst, this eventually leads to the Hillary Clinton is abusing children in a DC pizza parlor basement right now phenomenon. Too often, platform algorithms today target or facilitate those kinds of biases. The intent of platform providers and aggregators is not per se malicious. It's about mindshare. The code they write is designed to take you down a rabbit hole, to increase your time of engagement with that platform by giving you more of what the algorithm thinks you want, and to make more money off the engagement. But in the exchange, I'm afraid, our polarization has become that much more entrenched. So I urge you to watch carefully, mindfully, how the social media platforms are evolving, how they are managing and promoting content, how they are segmenting audiences, how do they deal with bad actors, how do their algorithms either discourage or perpetuate this tribalism. Be mindful and get engaged in how governments, local governments, state, federal, and foreign governments, go about regulating these platforms, or how government officials manipulate the feeds to their own political ends. You may have noticed that from time to time that seems already to be happening. Transparency in facts and context should always matter with this work. But in the defense of facts and transparency, we need to be nimble about how we organize, about how we educate the public, about how we can reach and inform people beyond our political bubble, and about how we respond to the new disruptions, technological and political, that are coming inevitably. In Georgia, a bill was introduced last year by a group of legislators concerned about fake news. Richard will talk more about this in a little. They proposed to create a state-sponsored entity to accredit journalists and to discipline those who didn't meet the standards. While the bill hadn't gotten much traction, it's still alive for next year's legislature to consider. I would suggest there are reasons to worry when politicians get involved in defining who is a credible journalist. But there's also a challenge when literally anyone can hold themselves out as a journalist, and when everyone with access to the internet is a publisher. So be vigilant, be innovative, and I wish you every success in fighting the good fight for open and transparent government and for a public that's informed by a broad, rather than bias-driven, marketplace of ideas. Thank you very much.
All right, not so fast, not so fast. Hyde, step over here just a second. So Hyde was honored nationally as in the Hall of Fame for state government organizations doing work to keep government open and transparent. So how was that ceremony, Hyde?
Well, I have Cynthia Counts to thank. I flew to Dallas, where it was, or I tried to fly to Dallas.
Did you actually get to Dallas for this event?
No, I didn't.
Where did you end up going to, Hyde?
I got to Houston.
You got to Houston. Did you get the frequent flyer miles for going to Dallas?
I got the frequent flyer miles for going
to Dallas.
But you
didn't get the trophy, did you?
No, I got... Just as far as Houston.
We are pleased to say that we have your trophy.
All right.
Thank you.
And there is one other thing. After how many years were you president of this organization?
Oh, I was president for about five, I guess.
5 years, but how long were you active with Holly Mannheimer at causing a ruckus? 20 years. Yes, yeah, 20 years. 20 years of this organization. Can you imagine how full the filing cabinets were? We started going through the filing cabinets, and we found something that we thought you would want to have. We found Lukavich's original cartoon for the foundation, Defender of the First. And we want you to have this.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. That's great. We had to stop using this because SBJ sued us because they had a similar looking dragon. So we had to put it in the closet.
Okay, well, now you got it on the wall.
Just to let you know, don't bring it back or
SBJ. Take your bling off the stage.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Now I want to transition into some more serious matters than cleaning out file cabinets. I want to talk about some of the things that are keeping me up at night. The web post was in bright white letters in a red box, the sort of notice that one sees when life or limb are at risk. "Stop the presses," it read. "The Waycross Journal Herald, which has been owned and operated by the Williams family since 1916, will cease publication as of September 30th. That big red warning notice was appropriate because as of now, Ware County, geographically the largest county in the state and with a population of more than 36,000 people, just became the 29th news desert in Georgia. That's 29 Georgia counties without a newspaper or other meaningful reporting as defined by the UNC Center for Innovation and Sustainability in Local Media. That's 29 counties without the county commissioners or the city councils getting a look at by a journalist. So one more newspaper bites the dust, right? Obsolete business model that couldn't deal with Craigslist, Facebook, Twitter, and the big national news websites. The problem is the void that local accountability journalism, its institutional collapse, is leaving behind. As Pew documents, voter participation in communities without local coverage falls off dramatically. The University of Chicago found that new bond issues cost taxpayers 11 basis points more in communities that became news deserts. That, folks, is real money. And how about the cost of government? County payrolls tend to swell following the collapse of a newspaper. The University of Chicago says with the median county payrolls jumping 1.4 million within a year of newspaper closings and a resulting tax increase of about $85 per capita. Kevin Riley, I have a new advertising campaign for the AJC. Buy a subscription and keep your taxes down. The fact is, governments without scrutiny quickly become inefficient. And we're not even talking about the opportunities for corruption. Well, what about scrutiny from citizen journalists? With the notable exception of Nydia Tisdale in this room, there are not too many citizen journalists in Georgia. And as Nydia will, I'm sure, be the first to tell you, you have to be a bit crazy to take on city and county governments without an editor and a support system. Asking the kind of questions that need to be asked, or even to simply show what happens in a council meeting or a political campaign event. This is going to present challenges for local governments, for us at the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, and at the AG's office. As I banged on at length about a year ago, while trust in media organizations is bad, trust in government, according to the most reputable polling, is dismal and falling, now down around 32 or 33%, depending on the poll. This means that citizens who don't have a news surrogate and who are upset about a particular issue or concern will, I predict, start to file even more open records requests. And unlike journalists who generally have had some practice at filing FOIA requests efficiently, many citizens, those wonderfully crazy gadflies, won't know how to do it well, and that will result in tension and frustration between the government officials and the citizens trying to figure things out. This will also likely result in more frustrated calls to the AG's office and the need for ever more patient public servants to answer the questions. At the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, we are seeing a discernible increase in emails from frustrated citizens begging for help, often without a clue on how to navigate our state's open records laws. Well, I'm delighted to say that with strong collaboration with the AG's office, we've just published an updated, streamlined, and practical guide to the Georgia Sunshine Laws. You've found a copy at your seat for each of you to take home. They're expensive to produce, so if you don't need it, please pass it along to somebody who does. For citizens, it is the first stop to understand how to gain access to public records and meetings. And Attorney General Carr, I want to thank you so much for the support of the hardworking people in your office for this incredibly important work, especially Jennifer Colangelo, who could not be here tonight, but certainly deserves a big shout out, and we should give her a round of applause. And I want to thank the William S. Morris Chair at Grady College, the National Freedom of Information Coalition, the Georgia Press Association for the big time financial help with getting this published. And in the pipeline, we have an update to the Blue Law Enforcement book in the works. And thanks to Holly Mannheimer and Peter Canfield, a new yellow book which aims to be a guide to open courts and court records. But shiny new red, blue, and yellow books aren't going to be enough. We're going to need to take this education work to the public and to public officials. We've been doing that big time this year, delivering open government seminars led by Georgia First Amendment Foundation volunteers with lots of experience with the law or extensive experience filing open records requests. Frankly, we've been preaching to full houses. And I don't think folks are coming for the donuts. The Georgia Municipal Association, the Association of County Commissioners of Georgia, all showed up. Even some large corporations are interested. We have a Fortune 100 company here in Atlanta that's asked us to do a seminar next week. And thanks to the very large gift from Cox last year, we have the resources to offer that training around the state. So if you'd like to attend training or bring training to your organization or your community, buttonhole John McCosh, he's the guy walking around with the camera. Raise your hand, John. That's John. Buttonhole him at the end of the evening. He has been scheduling the training and organizing it for our organization. Speaking of Cox, let's get back to government accountability from news organizations for a minute. You'll remember last year, the flap at the City of Atlanta over concealing and delaying records and documents that resulted in charges against city officials filed by the AG's office, and extensive reporting in a lawsuit from WSB Channel 2 and the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. You'll recall that the city, with a new mayor, settled the lawsuit and promised change. I'm happy to say that the process of change of the city has begun. It's not all been smooth sailing, and there's still plenty of reporter grumbling about slow-to-get records. But the city has hired a transparency officer, a chief transparency officer. She's just formalized an open records compliance policy, which closely tracks the requirements of state law, and then takes things slightly further. Most important, the policy sets up an automatic process of escalation when there are delays or high fees and creates a place where whistleblowers can go when they see the sunshine laws being ignored. The trick is for the City of Atlanta to create a culture of transparency that's sustainable. And if they can do that, that will be a huge win for the taxpayers and a huge win for the journalism organizations and the AG's office that collectively held the city accountable. But it is much harder for the AG's office when the open government dispute between the public or a news organization is with a state agency. The AG's office is really good at issuing opinions long before things get to litigation. But once court papers are filed, the AG's role must be to defend that state agency. That's Chris Carr's job. It's in the Constitution. I'd like to challenge Attorney General Carr and his terrific team to think about how we might ease that potential conflict. Whether there's a mechanism that could be created or come into play in those rare cases where the official responsible for enforcing open records laws finds him or herself in the unfortunate position of having to defend a state agency for not following the law. I do not have a clever solution, but we at the First Amendment Foundation think it's worth thinking about. I have another challenge for the journalists and those who believe in the value of accountability journalism in this room. As Hyde mentioned back in the last days of the Georgia legislative session back in April, six state representatives dropped HB 734 in the hopper, the so-called Ethics in Journalism Act. The bill calls, as Hyde said, for a journalism oversight board to be based at the University of Georgia's Grady College of Journalism and accreditation of all journalists working for news organizations in Georgia. And there's a snarky provision reflecting Georgia's open records laws where interview subjects would have the right to all outtakes and interview transcripts within 3 days of an interview, or the news organizations would face large fines. This, I might add, from the one part of government that is specifically exempted from Georgia's open records laws. Now, this bill, as written, is not going to go anywhere. If it did, the governor's already said he would veto it. And I won't ask any justices here to go on the record, but I don't think there's any Supreme Court justices, state or federal, who would decide such a law was constitutional. I bring this up because the bill was proposed by six well-respected, well-educated Georgians, a former missionary, a pharmacist, a doctor, a lawyer, a county agent, and a successful real estate developer. And none of them are in districts considered a news desert. 10 or 15 years ago, no one of their stature would have dared propose such a bill. They would have been laughed at or ridiculed when they went home to explain what they'd done this session. Now, in the siloed, algorithm-driven world Hyde spoke about, their views of frustration with journalism are mirrored by one-third of Americans, about half of Republicans, who agree with the President of the United States that the media are the enemy of the American people, not their friend. Those of us who believe in the importance of accountability journalism and open and transparent government as core principles in the preservation of democracy have to do a much better job of making our case. We must work much harder to explain why we do what we do and how we do what we do. And we definitely need to be a hell of a lot less arrogant and more humble when we make a mistake. As some of you know, I spend a lot of time in Eastern Europe these days helping news organizations facing challenges to their very existence from governments unconstrained by constitutions that protect the free flow of ideas or guarantee the right of a free and independent press, or for that matter, protect an independent judiciary. We simply cannot take the First Amendment protections and open government and open judiciary promises we celebrate tonight for granted. I want to end my remarks tonight with a shout out to some young people. There are four student journalists here from Emory University in Kennesaw State. Can you stand for me wherever you are? Where are you kids? Yes. Thank you. Thank you. They are here because they are passionate about journalism and they see a future where accountability journalism plays a vital role, and they're investing semesters of work to learn how to make a difference. And you may recall that you were greeted on arrival this evening by some young students. They're sophomores at Pace Academy. Would you mind standing for me? And your teachers, and your teachers. These are students, thank you. These are students who have made a 2-year commitment to give up many of their Sunday afternoons to go deep in their study of the First Amendment and what it means for our society. The program, part of the Isdell Center for Global Leadership at Pace, requires a real commitment. And after spending my first Sunday afternoon with them and answering their probing questions, I can tell you I am really optimistic about the future. But we cannot punt to the next generation. Waiting for these young people to come up with all the solutions that to the challenges Hyde and I have spoken about tonight, we must nurture and cherish the open government and First Amendment values that we share, and we must work harder than ever to make the case for those values so others have the opportunity to cherish them too. I hope everybody here will do your part. Now we're going to turn to Justice Hines. We're going to watch a brief video tribute to Justice Hines, created by Foundation board member and Channel 5 reporter Dale Russell, edited by Dale's colleague Randy Reinhardt. And Kathy is going to get us going.
You may think you know Harris Hines because he made you laugh about cameras in the courtroom.
Don't let me say something stupid or don't let me, you know, scratch my head at the wrong time.
Or talk to you about the key to his success.
If it comes down to hard work, I'll take my chances.
Harris Hines was everything you thought he was and so much more. The man you think you knew actually lived a life full of surprises. Harris Hines grew up on the outskirts of Piedmont Park and attended Spring Street Elementary School in downtown Atlanta. He was an only child of Reuben and Edith Hines, gregarious and adventurous. His wife Helen says he described his childhood as deliriously happy.
He said that Doris Day's song, Blue Skies, was just right up his alley.
Blue skies smiling at me.
Blue skies, sunshine, green grass. It was his childhood. It was happy.
How happy? It may surprise you to know young Harris had a buddy named Gene who often invited him over to spend the night at his house. That house was the old governor's mansion in Ansley Park. Gene was Eugene Talmadge Jr., son of Governor Herman Talmadge.
He laughingly said that Mrs. Talmadge was often the room mother for their grade, and that they had real nice Christmas parties.
Harris went on to attend Grady High School, where he set the academic world on fire. Well, sort of.
I think he was a good student, but he was certainly not the valedictorian, I guess you'd say. He just enjoyed a lot of different things.
What things? Surprisingly, though small in stature, Harris had a huge athletic talent for any sport, baseball, football, even
amazingly was on the varsity basketball team at Grady for, I guess, 2 years, and they were really good team.
Number 23 was a whirling bundle of energy who played for arguably one of the best coaches in American football history, Irk Russell. Another surprise to Bob Grayson, Harris's first law partner.
Although I grew up in Atlanta, I didn't know Irk Russell coached at Grady High School until Harris informed me of that.
Harris was so competitive, his classmates voted him most likely to succeed and go on to become Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. Well, actually, he was voted
most athletic. It comes as a shock to many people. If he was going to play football or play baseball, he was going to give it all he had. Very determined, tenacious.
And later, when Harris became a father of two college athletes, Mary Margaret and Hap, Harris's passion on the field extended to the stands.
I have heard he was as fierce an observer of his children's games as he was a participant when he played.
Oh, that's putting it mildly. That's very, very true. He did it by trying to coach, referee, and cheerlead all at the same time.
Harris graduated from Emory, then Emory Law School, when he met Helen. Harris's grandfather, Reuben, told him, "She's your best chance, don't mess this up." And he didn't. The new lawyer and the young school teacher were talking marriage, ready to move on and start a new life. Well, almost ready.
He lived at home all the way through college, law school, and his first job. He didn't leave until we married, and I think if I had agreed to it, we would have just moved in with his parents still.
Once he left home and got married, Harris Hines attacked the law with the same dogged work ethic he showed on the backfields of Spring Street. Before long, a young governor with a big future ahead of him saw potential and appointed Harris to the Cobb County State Court.
He had impeccable manners, and he always treated everybody like he would like to be treated himself. And that, I think that was his signature trait, is how well he loved people and people loved him.
He loved being a judge, didn't he?
He did. It fit.
But Judge Hines had to quickly shift to candidate Hines. When he ran for re-election, he faced opposition, won in a landslide. It would be the first of 12 different races and another surprise.
After he won that one judicial race, he never had another judicial opponent.
Either he was really good or he was really lucky.
He was really good.
What was his secret?
He went to wherever two or more were gathered, he was there.
Harris moved from state court to Superior Court, then to Supreme Court, and finally, Supreme Court Chief Justice. As Harris's career took off, he developed an open and transparent attitude about the role of the media in the courtroom.
If we show that our system, and I think it's the greatest system of all, let me say, I think we are blessed with a wonderful judicial system. I think he's of the belief that if people see that, they will see the fundamental fairness of it.
As a Superior Court judge in the early 90s, Harris ruled in favor of the Marietta Daily Journal in a health care lawsuit over Georgia sunshine laws.
Harris had ruled in favor of open records, and the Court of Appeals affirmed his decision. That's a landmark case.
Later, Justice Hines also wrote the court's unanimous opinion in Howard v. Sumter Free Press, which compelled the Sumter County Sheriff's Office to comply with the State Open Records Act.
What made him a good judge or justice?
Probably the same qualities that made him a good person and a good lawyer. He was honest to a fault. He cared about people. He was kind.
Tonight, the First Amendment Foundation is proud to honor former Chief Justice Harris Hines. We welcome his family and are glad to highlight his lifetime of service, his support of the First Amendment Foundation, and his most enduring legacy.
Harris, if he were here and you were asking him, he would probably say, of all the things that he did in his life, the most important was marrying Helen, and the second was being able to raise his children to be what they are.
We are honored, and Harris would be honored. He had a very rich, fulfilled life. We feel some very great pride and satisfaction in, and he should too.
It's now my pleasure to introduce Supreme Court Chief Justice Harold Melton. Harold Melton was appointed to the Supreme Court in 2005. He became Chief Justice in 2018. And before joining the court, he served as executive counsel to Governor Sonny Perdue. Chief Justice Melton spent 11 years in the Georgia Department of Law under two attorneys general. He holds a Bachelor of Science degree from Auburn University and a JD from the University of Georgia. Keeping it in the SEC there, I notice. Chief Justice Melton serves on local and national boards of Young Life Ministries. He's also a board member of Atlanta Youth Academies. He grew up in East Point and Marietta, and lives in Atlanta with his wife, Kimberly, and their three children. Justice Melton.
Thank you, Richard. Wow, what a great night. It's a pleasure to be in your presence, especially on this occasion. There's a lot I like about this night. First of all, we're talking about the First Amendment. And we talk about the amendments to our Constitution, and our freedom of speech, it made it to the top 10. And in fact, it's impressive to think that when our drafters, our framers of our Constitution, wrote everything they thought that needed to be written and sat down and said, hold on, let's make sure we got everything right. The first thing they started out with was an amendment that included the freedom of speech. So, an organization that is dedicated to upholding the principles of freedom of speech is a formidable and important organization. So it's a pleasure to be in your presence. And then to add to that, the ability to honor my dear friend, Chief Justice Hines, judge to me. Everybody's got a name for him, all of them positive. But I had interned with him when he was a Superior Court judge. We've been lunch buddies for close to 30 years and have gotten to know and love the family, and they've been dear to me. So this is a great combination to be in your presence at a group that honors the First Amendment and to be able to pay tribute to such a dear friend as Chief Justice Hines. You met a lot of the colleagues that were here, that are here, Presiding Justice Namias and the other justices on the court, and I think Chief Judge McFadden on the Court of Appeals is here, and maybe some others from the Court of Appeals, and Judge Jackson and Judge Whitaker, the AG. But I also want to introduce to you a couple of people from our Public Information Office. Miss Jane Hansen, where are you? All right. Oh, there you are. Wanted to make sure you hadn't left. And Miss Amy Haddon, where's Amy Haddon? Okay, there she is. So they are in our public information office, and I just want you to make sure you know them. And if they are serving you well, say thank you. If not, give them some coaching. So in the past, I've had opportunity to speak of Justice Hines on a number of occasions since we lost him, almost a year ago. In the past, I talked about certain attributes of his. He's known by many of his attributes, and you saw some of those in the video. But one of those is, you know, he's a nice guy. But there are times when you can get on his bad side, and you can start see him getting irritated. And one of the things that would irritate him is if you resisted his ability, his desire, to serve you in some form or fashion. He would say something like, now let me know if you need anything. I said, yes, Judge, okay, I got it. Now let me know, serious, I'm serious, and I'm not joking. Let me know if you need anything. Yes, sir, I'll let you know. Harold, I'm not playing with you now, and you can start getting mad. He's just getting mad thinking about the prospect that I might have a need and might be so bold as not to ask him. And by the time I'm leaving, he's mad because I might not ask him. But I love that on this occasion, we got to see beyond his attributes, we got to see the full life. Because when we look at the full life, there are some things that I think really stand out. And the first of those, of course, is family. Family that raised him, the family that he came to know and love with his wife, Helen, otherwise known as mother or mom, Mary Margaret, known as Sis, James Harris, known as Hap, and they've all gotten married and they've got grandkids. But these are the people who he lived with on a daily basis and he would do anything for. And there are lessons to be learned when we see what family meant to him and what he meant to family. And the first is family is important. Family still matters. Without family, we fall apart. Without family, society falls apart. And I know it sounds hokey, but it's still true. It's still the best institution that we have. We all like to think that everybody's a good person. It's politically correct to talk about everybody's good, everybody's good. Well, I don't know that we really start off good. I know babies are born and before too long, they learn to say no. And then when they increase their vocabulary, they learn to say mine. They don't grow up naturally wanting to share. It takes a parent. It takes parents. It's a team sport. It takes parents to teach kids to share, to say I'm sorry, to learn to look after somebody else, to help somebody else, to encourage somebody. It takes parents to teach somebody to do that. You know, there's that book that was out several years ago that said, everything I needed to learn, I learned in kindergarten. Y'all know that's a lie. Because the reality is, everything I need to learn and should have learned but didn't, I learned to hide. I learned to mask over it. Here's my proof. Anybody here manage people? Have you ever managed people and thought, hey, these are adults. Why am I having to deal with this? It's because it's not really true that we learned everything we need to learn in kindergarten. We should have learned it, but we learned to hide that we didn't learn it. And so it takes parents. It takes parents to grow us up to become the people that we want to be. Family teaches us to, it teaches us an instruction. Family teaches us to be our guide. It is our guide. It teaches how to build up the infrastructure to the people that we want to become. It teaches us how to be sure of who we are. It teaches us to be sure of whose we are. It teaches us to be sure of what we stand for. Family does that. And it seems like today we might even be afraid to shoot for this ideal, to shoot for a family that is functional and serving in all these capacities. And I think one reason why we might be afraid is simply because we fail. We fail often. But I'll give you this. Let's shoot for it. Let's shoot for the ideal. Nothing great has ever been accomplished because without being idealistic. Let's shoot for the ideal. And if you fail, I won't get mad at you. But I want you to promise me this. If I fail, I don't want you to get mad at me either. We could dust each other off, encourage each other to redirect our focus, and try again. These are goals worth striving for. You also see that when you look at his family, you see a dedication to service to others. And embedded in that is this notion. And you see it when you see Justice Hines. Embedded is this notion that I'm no better than you, and you're no better than me. I'm no better than you, and you're no better than me. And because of that, we see certain aspects played out in his life. He said often, he spoke of his idyllic childhood, every child deserves to have a loving family. And because I'm no better than you, and you're no better than me, if there's somebody who didn't have that kind of family, well then, that means something of me. And he looked at his mother, His mother, who's a school teacher, she chose to teach in the inner city schools. She chose to teach school in schools where kids didn't have the home life and the finances and the resources. And she made sure that they had Christmas gifts, and she made sure that they had shoes. And he had a dad who was a salesman, and he traveled around and he bought a Christmas suit, a Santa suit, before the day when they had professional Santa Claus. And he would serve as Santa Claus on the weekends in these department stores. He saw the example of his parents and realized, because everybody deserves a loving family, and the only difference between my family and his family and the kids that grew up in a different family is just the luck of the draw, which meant that there's something to be called from of him and those around him. We had to backfill. We had to provide the backfill for those who did not have that loving family. It wasn't a duty. It wasn't an obligation. It was just something you did. Just something you did. You brush your teeth. You get an oil change every 3,000 miles. You serve those around you. It's just what you did. The other thing is, you see and you look at his life, because I'm no better than you and you're no better than me, there was a real desire to serve your friends. A real desire to serve your friends. When I got to know Judge Hines a little bit better, I tend to make fun of people, give them a hard time. And I was with him one time, and I said, I'm remembering back now when I was working for him, and I used to look up to judges a lot. I still do, frankly. And as an intern, you know, I'd see Judge Hines walk the streets of Marietta and Cobb County, and people just looked up to him. Hey, Judge, everything was Judge. Judge Bodiford agrees. You got some of that, too. And I remember seeing him leave the parking deck one time. And he left. He was driving a Chrysler Reliant K car. And he's a family man, so he was driving the wagon version. And there was a side mirror that was hanging by the wires. And I want to say, I might be embellishing, I want to say that there was a cracked windshield. But it was a K car, it was a wagon, it was a cracked windshield, and there was a dangling. I said, this is what Judge Hines drives. So I would say, Judge, what's up with the K car? Well, I never learned what was up with the K car. Let me tell you what was up with the K car. In the early 80s, Chrysler was struggling. He had a friend who had a Chrysler dealership. For him, it didn't mean come over and have dinner with me. For him, it meant that when it's time to buy a car, what do? You buy a K car. That's what's up with the K car. I'm no better than you. You're no better than me. The only difference is where we are in life. We serve, and that's what he ended up doing. Fairness. His idea of fairness is born out of this same concept. I'm no better than you. You're no better than me. We just have different starting points. And that was the source of his fairness. You are wise First Amendment Foundation folks for recognizing his accomplishments, his value of his service in the area of the First Amendment, open government. But you should also know that that's just one small part of his fairness. And the fairness that he exhibited was not born out of intellectual prowess, although he was plenty smart, Emory grad, undergrad, and law school, but it was a basic sense of fairness and fair play. And you might even call some of his analysis by golly analysis. And by golly analysis is simply, by golly, that can't be right. And there's a certain rhythm that comes with reading the law. And whether you have the intellectual power to decipher all these machinations, it's still important to be able to catch the rhythm of law and to sync up with that rhythm and know when it makes sense and when it doesn't make sense. And he had that rhythm. So his fairness was very much in the span of the First Amendment, but you should know that it was a lot broader than that. There are some things, as much as I love him and much as I respect him, there are some things that he was just not good at. There are some things he just did not get on top of. One of those was computers. He did not understand computers. He did not. And I went to go see him when I first got on the court. I was sitting in his office, and I said, Judge Hines, where's your computer? And he pointed over to the credenza, and he said, it used to be over there until I had him come get it. And then his wife and daughter conspired, and they bought him an iPhone. Now, before they bought him the iPhone, he had a little flip phone. They bought him this iPhone. And I said, because I like giving him a hard time, I said, you know that's a computer, don't you? And I saw Mary Mark said, don't tell him that, he won't use it. The other thing he didn't understand was tattoos. He did not understand lots of tattoos. The more tattoos you had, the more he didn't understand. But this is what he did understand. He knew how to treat people fairly. He knew that regardless of how you looked, what you looked like, what you did, he was going to treat you fairly, with respect, with dignity. And in fact, if you happen to be a tattoo computer consultant, he would get to know you, he would get to appreciate you, he would tell you about Cobb County, and he would likely hand out one of these Supreme Court lapel pins that he handed out like they were candy. Here's why I'm glad, though, that you have chosen to honor my good friend, Chief Justice Hines. And I'm back up a little bit. Barney Fife was given an orientation to one of his inmates at the jail. And he said, there are just two rules here at the Rock. Rule number one, obey all rules. Rule number two, no writing on the walls. As I look at what's going on culturally and in society, it seems to me that there are two rules that characterize our society, two standards, two norms. The first one is defy all norms, defy them. The second one is be good to the environment. Now, one of those is helpful and healthy. One of them, I think, has its challenges. My fear is this. There are some things that are being discarded that I think we really need to hold dear. And those things that we need to hold dear to are things that he embodied. They're not sexy. They're not new. They're not fancy. Whatever we do, folks, let's love our kids. Let's tell them, let's nurture them, challenge them. Tell them that you are theirs and they are yours, and there's nothing they can do that will ever change that. Give them the security to know that nothing will ever change that. For those that we know who haven't grown up with that kind of family, it's up to us to backfill, to do something meaningful, to backfill, to build those people up, to send them up and out into this world. Many times doing this won't cost us anything. Many times it's going to cost us a lot. It might even mean that we drive a K car, maybe in a wagon. But the goal here is that we have a life that's fulfilling for ourselves and for our posterity. A life that's full of being loved and a life that is full of loving others. That's what it means to honor this man. Thank you for honoring him. Thank you for honoring this great family. And can we all go and do likewise?
Thank you, Chief Justice. I'd now like to bring to the stage Susan Yao. She is the daughter of the late Chief Justice Charles Weltner, for whom our award is named. And this is the award. Mrs. Hines, we've seen the video tribute. We've heard from Justice Melton. It's now time to present. It's my distinct honor to present the 2019 Weltner Freedom of Information Award to the family of Chief Justice Harris Hines, our tribute to his legacy. Before we head home, I'd like to thank a few people. Board member John McCosh, who worked so hard on the advertising for this event, and you see running around with the camera, thank you. Associated Planners of Georgia, especially Lenora Kopkin. And lastly, Kathy Brister. Would you mind stepping up here for a moment, please? Kathy Brister is the Grand Dame of Organization, one of our board members, who spent countless hours putting together tonight's event. And if you would like to help with next year's event, let Kathy or me know. Kathy, thank you so, so very much. Thank you all for coming. Thank you for your vigorous support of this organization. Thanks for doing good in the world.